You will receive an identity disc. Everything you do or learn will be imprinted on this disc. If you lose your disc or fail to follow commands, you will be subject to immediate de-resolution.
Mirroring complete. Disc activated and synchronized. Proceed to games.
Games? What am I supposed to do?
Survive.
Okay, so let's get started.
So what exactly is a technocrat, or technocracy? Well, technocrats, in the general sense, are technical experts who hold political office. They differ from regular politicians because they have more specialized expertise in non-political fields. Usually, these academic professionals function as advisors, but in a technocracy, they themselves rule. They are often elected for their specific skills that complement whatever crisis a nation is going through. Technocracies are heavily associated with communist governments, although the political philosophy was also briefly popular in the United States during the Depression era.
Technocracy, the New School for Social Research and the University in Exile, and Jet Propulsion Laboratories, all of which were founded in the 1930s. Technocracy Inc. formed in 1931 to promote the ideas of Howard Scott. Scott saw government and industry as wasteful and unfair, and believed that an economy run by engineers would be efficient and equitable. He called for the price system and fiat currencies to be replaced with a system based on how much energy it takes to produce specific goods. Scott called for engineers to run a continental government, the Green New Deal, which is basically technocracy come to life. A system where they'll change money out for energy credits.
But using energy as the new metric of value for the post-carbon economy is just one element of the neo-technocratic vision. When Hubbert wrote his technocracy study course, he made it clear that technocracy could not come to fruition without 24/7 surveillance of all energy usage and a continuous stream of data about all goods being produced by and consumed by society. But whereas in the 1930s such a system must have seemed like a delusional flight of fancy, today it is already being implemented.
Smart cities are more responsive to citizens and they help reduce environmental impact.
They're more cost-effective and they're safer.
Smart cities make people happier and more connected to their community.
The current CIA director, David Petraeus, was quoted as saying, "We're going to use smart appliances to spy on you."
Mobile phone industry explores worldwide tracking of users. Until now, the use of mobile phone tracking in the fight against COVID-19 has been restricted to just national governments.
Moscow is using facial recognition to enforce their quarantine. Cameras are monitored from a purpose-built CV-19 control center, where images and personal data of those under quarantine are put into a database so that they can be recognized by the cameras. South Korea has been using surveillance cameras, mobile phone location data, and credit card records. In Hong Kong, those under quarantine are being made to wear location tracking wristbands.
The Rockefeller Foundation, which, by the way, is the same group that seeded not only the United Nations, but as well the World Health Organization. This document is called Scenarios for the Future of Technology in International Development. The document was to explore the many ways in which technology and development could co-evolve. They claim, in order to, quote, address a wide range of developmental challenges from climate change, healthcare, agriculture to housing, transportation and education. Oh, is that all? This was released in 2010. A world of tighter, top-down government control and more authoritarian leadership with limited innovation and growing citizen pushback. During the pandemic, national leaders around the world flexed their authority and imposed airtight rules and restrictions, from the mandatory wearing of face masks to body temperature checks at the entries to communal spaces like train stations and supermarkets. Even after the pandemic faded, more authoritarian control and oversight of citizens and their activities stuck and even intensified. First, the notion of a more controlled world gained wide acceptance and approval. Right here in America, I would agree. Citizens willingly gave up some of their sovereignty and their privacy. In developed countries, this heightened oversight took many forms. Biometric ID for all citizens. Remember, one of the main proponents of this whole thing that we're seeing speak out is Bill Gates. And what is he saying that we need to do before order and economic growth can come back?
For the world at large, normalcy only returns when we've largely vaccinated the entire global population.
Some of the headlines in lockstep, it talks about quarantine restricts in-person contact. It also says intercontinental trade hit by pathogen controls. We're already seeing this in the media where they're saying that they're going to have to do that as a result of saving us. Technology in lockstep says the scenarios point to the development of certain kinds of technologies. Technological innovation in lockstep is largely driven by government issues of national security, of health and safety, shaped by government's dual desire to control and monitor their citizens. It's all about control. Technology we might see, scanners using advanced functional magnetic resonance imaging, become the norm at airports and other public interests to, get this guys, detect abnormal behavior that might indicate antisocial intent, telling you exactly what they intend to do.
You know, up to now, I kept thinking that everything science did was good. My training, I suppose. Now I'm not so sure.
In the Soviet Union, beginning in the 1930s, many engineering experts were promoted into political leadership, creating what might have been the first technocratic government.
The new school itself was begun in 1917, after Columbia University imposed a loyalty oath to the United States upon the entire faculty. Some faculty wouldn't swear a loyalty oath to the United States, and they quit, and they set up this new school for social research. They brought over a ton of scholars who were being ejected or felt threatened by the regimes in Europe. Why might they have felt threatened? Could it be because their ideas were extremely subversive? Another thing that happened in the 30s, which is the setup of jet propulsion laboratories. It was 1933, and this basically became NASA. Another member of Jet Propulsion Labs, of course, was Jack Parsons, and Jack Parsons was partnered with L. Ron Hubbard and Aleister Crowley and their cults. But what this all adds up to me is the cult of progress. These guys were promising progress in technology and a better future. And these guys were promising what they were calling social progress, which allegedly is supposed to lead to greater human rights and freedom for all. We move to the 40s with the Office of Scientific Research and Development. That was started by a guy called Vannevar Bush. Vannevar Bush is famous because he was an early technocrat. He also envisioned a future where machines would kind of do all our work for us. He wrote this book, As We May Think. Dulles, that's the leader of the CIA. In 1951, Dulles hired a chemist to design and oversee a systematic search for the key to mind control. This letter that was written by then CIA Director Gates, it was written in 1986, but it's a history of how the CIA worked with academia. William J. Donovan persuaded President Roosevelt of the need to organize a coordinated foreign intelligence service. He proposed that the service, quote, draw on the universities for experts. The prominent schools that they drew from were Harvard, Columbia, Yale, and the New School. Hadja Holborn was key in this regard. While teaching at Yale, Holborn taught at least one seminar at Harvard and participated in others at Columbia. Recall this list of people working with the CIA, Hadja Holborn. Don't let it escape your attention as to how many of these people and these ideas were used in the setup of all of these things. What have we gotten as a result? European Union and the United Nations? Communist China has risen? Our skies are full of technology, which helps them to spy and helps them to send signals all around the world. They are shaping the nation in a way that reminds me of communism. They promised us human rights. They promised us equality. They promised us technological perfection, flying cars, and a system where everybody was equal. Instead, we got censorship. Instead, we got a medical tyranny. Instead, we got 24/7 tracking of our every move. Instead, we got infertility and debt and mind control and a population of angry, drugged up people.
You want another fight?
No, I'm okay.
Yeah, let's do it. First, it's easy.